On the air, do you think we've come any closer collectively to understanding the dangers of central planning and fiat currency?
Well, Josh, I think you're right in that one of the reasons we like to do the show is to educate folks about some of the things that are going on in the central banking and the banking industry. And most people think that it's too complicated for them to really delve into how it works and why it's a problem. And we try to break through that. And, you know, wherever we go, we do meet people who are now more aware of how the system works and why it's dangerous. And there are pockets of protest and resistance. You know, we call it the global insurrection against banker occupation. It takes many forms, whether it's the Arab Spring or Occupy Wall Street or various demonstrations around the world. I think they're all connected to this byproduct of having a cartel of central bankers do enormous damage.
Well, even initially, the Tea Party movement, before it kind of got a little hijacked, was initially against the banking system, and it obviously it changed over time, and we've seen that with a lot of groups, unfortunately. But it started, I think, more about ending the Federal Reserve and putting an end to central planning, quantitative easing, fractional reserve, and you know, it's hard to keep a movement steady for a long time and keep people, you know, fighting for the same cause. People come in, funders, people start funding the movements, and then next thing you know, they're talking about lynching politicians, and it becomes a bit different than the initial idea. But I feel like people are starting to become more and more aware of what central planning is. I mean, a few years ago, you tell someone about the Federal Reserve, and most people wouldn't know what you're talking about. But today, still not a lot of people know what you're talking about, but at least there's a good number of people who say, oh yeah, I saw something about that. I saw Ron Paul talk about that. I saw Max Keiser talk about that. And it seems to be starting to come together. But do you see an end to this system in the near future?
Well, first of all, why are people more aware of what's going on in the central banking system? Certainly there are shows like ours, and there's a lot of media that is dedicated to exposing what central banks are doing. But the other aspect to it is that the economy has become financialized. And institutions in our country, education or religious institutions or other great pillars of society, if you will, have been overcome or overtaken by financialization. Doctors are leaving the profession to become hedge fund managers. You know, people watch CNBC. What's the financial network? Is it CNBC?
There's Bloomberg, CNBC.
CNBC, right? Yeah. They watch that really as the background to their day. And so since they become more involved in finances and trading, of course, then they naturally start to learn about banking and central banking. And so that's part of the transformation of society toward a more financialized economy. And you also then would have two groups, vested groups, those that are now riding the bull market and becoming very wealthy. So they're not going to want to buck the system. And then you have others who think that, well, there are bigger issues at play than simply making it easier for cartel players to get wealthier, you know. So if that I tell you, Josh, I don't think I answered your question. What was the original question?
Well, do you think that we will see an end to this system in the coming years?
That's where cryptocurrency comes in, Bitcoin and other currencies, because it is a true alternative. It is a brilliant technology, is like the Gutenberg press put out, you know, the Catholic Church that put them out of business practically. And, you know, technology comes along, paradigms are shifted, and Bitcoin is such a huge shift. And I like to think of it as money without a flag. There's no flag attached to it. And people are essentially creating their own financial system and banking system and putting the current system out of business, just like the Enlightenment put the Catholic Church, you know, out of business for the most part.
Well, it's a big sign of people losing faith in the fiat system when they're flooding money, especially going from $18 billion market cap for all cryptos in January to topping at about $115 billion. That's a massive rise. I mean, it might not be anything compared to some of the big companies that we see out there, but it shows that people are losing faith in that system. It's a free market system. People can trade and do what they wish and not have to worry about, you know, getting extorted for half the money that they make, fair and square. And on top of that, there's my next question, which is there's the decentralized cashless society, which is basically just a freedom of individuals, but then there's the centralized cashless society. So we're watching what's happening in India, Australia, China, Sweden, Canada to a large extent, M0 in the United States. It has been kind of topsy-turvy lately. So do you think that there is a concerted effort to create a cashless society, even on a global scale, because there seems to be a lot of test grounds throughout the world?
Yeah, sure, because it gives governments another way to monitor people mm-hmm. and to censor people and to destroy a lot of the freedoms that we take for granted in countries like the U.S. and elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And these two things are running in parallel. You have the birth of a decentralized cryptocurrency as well as a more centralized attempt to replicate blockchain, but under the control of a government. And this is where the battle lines have been drawn. I think that the crypto community, as we saw in the scaling debate, they rally. I think it shows that they rally to a common good that is admirable and mm-hmm. shows that they can take on the central governments more. You know, there was this fear that intercene in battle within the crypto community that the pockets of interested parties would kind of co-opt or make it less robust. But I think we're saying that that's not the case.
Absolutely. Well, I often tell people with a centralized cashless society, if your money's in the bank, it's not yours, it's the bank's. And if your money's always going through the banks, through digital transactions, and you never hold it in your hand, doesn't that mean the bank basically owns all your money? And this is something that I'm a little worried about. At the recent Davos forum, they were talking about, this Nobel laureate was talking about creating a global cashless society through the special drawing rights. And that concerns a lot of people. And unfortunately, a lot of people mix it up with cryptos and don't understand the difference. But nonetheless, I mean, that would be a very dangerous future to walk into, far more dangerous even than the current fiat system.
Yeah, convenience is a great selling point. And in China, they really, in huge pockets of the population, they are completely cashless. It's all done with mobile phones and mm-hmm. QR codes.
Yeah.
And but it's obviously under the very tight control. The government is very on top of things there. And so it will be a battle, I agree. You know, mm-hmm. that this is where it's going to be. The fight for freedom, you know, it's going to be along these lines. And so I think the nation state as we know it, though, and the idea of money attached to a flag, as I said,
mm-hmm.
I think that's run its course. And it's just the time and cycles and things kind of come and go. And I think the nation state as we know it is kind of in demise. The United States, I think, is really in demise. Yeah, I see that as really losing its position as world leader in many ways, and we're seeing the rise of a completely different global economy, more localization, and you can talk about that for a while in terms of what that might look like. But I think that this is a rear guard action by countries to try to mimic blockchain, which I don't think will be successful.
Yeah, I think that we're probably winning. I think this just shows a sign of desperation. And everyone I talk to seems to believe the same thing. I talked to Ron Paul last week, and he was saying, there's no chance that this is going to go through. There's no chance that we are going to see a global cashless society because people are smart enough not to buy into that. We'll see cashless societies throughout the world in different sovereign countries. But otherwise, I mean, the bankers are going down right now. I mean, the level of awareness that's growing within throughout the world about fiat central planning and the amount of support that cryptos have had, it's incredible. So finishing it off, Max, what's going on with your show, The Kaiser Report? I've noticed you've been all over the place. You've been reporting. You were in Mexico recently. You were talking to Jeff Berwick. And I've just noticed you're in the woods sometimes. Like, what's going on?
Well, we're always moving around, and you know, we'd like to travel,
yeah,
and do the show in different locations. And we were in Paris originally. Then mm-hmm. we were in London for quite some time. London became very difficult. You know, London, people probably are not aware that it's not really, they don't really support free speech.
Mm-hmm.
So
nope.
The regulators in the UK were constantly threatening us.
Mm-hmm.
And
what kind of threats? Like, what were they threatening you with?
They were threatening in a very belligerent manner. Made us feel as though our safety was not really, you know, secure. So, on behalf of some energy companies
mm-hmm.
and Ofcom, which is their regulator in the UK,
mm-hmm.
they work with corporations
mm-hmm.
to stifle speech. In the UK, they're trying to get fracking in a big way.
Mm-hmm.
And if the biggest group of activists and journalists that have been murdered over the past 10, 15 years are those in the environmentalist movement
mm-hmm.
and ecological warriors, if you will.
Mm.
You know, people say that, journalists are getting killed in this country or that country. The biggest group are environmentalists. They've been killed, hundreds of them.
It's always suicide, right? They committed suicide. They crashed a car. I've seen that a lot over the past few years, and it's quite alarming to a lot of people like us who try to talk about, you know, just the truth. It's as simple as that.
The energy companies are ruthless and mercenary and dangerous.
Mm.
And so they made us very uncomfortable in terms of the threats that we got from them just for mentioning them. And the thing is that in the UK, the regulators like Ofcom work for corporate assassins, essentially, and so it's not really worth hanging out there. You know, in the U.S., it's still a beacon of free speech in many ways. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you have a lot of posturing that goes on,
mm-hmm.
and people are shouted down, if you will, or you have a certain cadre of journalists who are protectionist of certain interests. You know, in the U.S., it's not the energy industry that's the most dangerous, but it's the essentially the Hollywood
mm-hmm.
cartel, the copyright industry, is really the most wicked.
You know a few things about Hollywood, I would assume. And, you know, it's funny because what you're talking about, it kind of brings me back to that phrase, go into the woods, you know, disappear mm-hmm. into the woods, because you've literally been in the woods in a lot of your shows. And I mean, the view, obviously, in London isn't worth risking your life over. And I think that the content is what people are looking for. And what you're putting out is something that people can relate to, because a lot of people are frustrated. A lot of people want to hear the latest on all this. And you do a great job of it. And you add something that's much needed in this very boring financial world, and that is humor. And I mean, I really appreciate that. And I appreciate talking with you today, Max. Thank you.
Josh, it's been an honor and a pleasure.